Hi there, and welcome to ArtSync, Toronto's visual voice for contemporary art. I'm Owen McDermott. We begin this week's episode of new shows by artists both emerging and established who work in painting, photography, and new media. After the openings, we'll announce the ArtSync pick for the best exhibit of 2010 and air the interview that helped convince us. First, though, to Gallery 44, where artist Simon Glass has exfoliated biblical verse into a show of photographs about creation and destruction. He spoke to Tally about Jeremiah 4, 23 to 27.
Hi, I'm here at Gallery 44 with artist Simon Glass. Thank you for talking to us.
Thank you.
And so explain to our viewers what your show is about.
Well, this is a body of photographs entitled Jeremiah 4, 23 to 27. The work has been inspired by the book of Jeremiah and that chapter and those verses precisely. The landscapes are photographs shot in the Judean and Negev deserts. And I have an interest in Hebrew biblical scripture. So that's a brief introduction to the show.
And why particularly the book of Jeremiah? Rather than, you know, another part of the good book?
Well, I developed an interest in the book of Jeremiah when I noticed that there was an important affinity between Jeremiah's writings and the writings in the book of Genesis that have to do with the relationship between creation and destruction.
And, you know, it's seemingly religion plays a small and smaller part in the lives of Canadians. Is this that something that concerns you?
No. I'm actually careful to try to see that my artwork doesn't document my beliefs, because I don't think it's really that important what one person believes. However, my beliefs may shape my work, just I don't document them with it.
And so most of these are photographs, but tell us about the installation piece with Hebrew writing on it.
Well, the installation piece that you're referring to, Tally, is the part of a wing of a 1958 Cessna. And the reason that I've chosen that is because that I see this piece of aircraft as technological detritus. And also, I think that at the beginning of the 21st century, there are associations to be made with aircraft parts. I leave it to people's imaginations.
Great. And how long does the show run until?
The show runs from today, January 7th, until February the 12th.
Okay, thank you so much, Mr. Glass.
Tally, thank you very much.
Next, Tally interviewed two emerging artists featured in OCAD's student gallery group show, Real Time. Aaron Briggs and Kyle Duffield talked the temporality of hope, the narcissism of technologies, and the artist's place in the digital world.
The OCAD Student Gallery with Aaron and Kyle. So we'll start with Aaron. Why don't you tell us what your work is all about, which is right behind here, by the way.
Well, this is my thesis work from last year, and it actually is the missing people throughout Canada. I was working with the websites that have the missing people on them, which is actually only five provinces right now. And I was thinking about aspects of hope and time and how as we really go back in time with the people that are missing, as the list goes back to 1935, there's really not much hope. They're more of an abstract being than any sort of physical presence. And if you look at someone who's went missing yesterday, they're really there. There's still this life to them. There's a hope to them. So I use that to paint in inverse proportion how long I would be painting. And it starts 1935 at 10 seconds. So it's literally a brush stroke. It becomes an abstraction that captures the essence, and they become more and more detailed as time goes on, really just discussing the feelings that would go along with that.
All right. And what about the black squares? What's the idea behind those?
The black squares actually do represent people. On the back of them, they are different people. Everything's signed with their dates, where they went missing, and their names. Not everybody in their case file, though, does have a photograph. And for me, because I started looking at these people because I felt they needed a voice, they needed to be validated, I wanted to make sure they had a space. So it really ended up being a design feature in it as well in the end, but it was really just giving everyone their moment.
And now on to Kyle. Kyle, tell me about My Face.
My Face is pretty much an automated social networking service. What it does is it uses face tracking technology, pretty much detects participants within the room, and then pretty much spams a desktop at a rate of about five times per second. So pretty much what I'm trying to do with this is talk about both the idea of pretty much the internet. I mean, it's a very obviously prevalent and impressive tool, but I think in most applications on the consumer level, it dwells in narcissism. So pretty much I'm trying to get into the idea of the immediacy of narcissism and trying to get out that pretty much irrelevant information as quick as possible and just kind of have fun with it.
So is My Face only available here at the gallery, or can we also see it? Are you going to put it online? Is there any sort of plans to do that?
I haven't quite figured it out yet. I may, if I do release it, I'll release it as free software. I mean, there's no way I could ever sell it because there's certain patent issues and whatnot, but I'm going to try to get it in other spaces as well and get it out there, because I think that almost extends the message of it all.
Great. So, Aaron, back to you. How do you think the internet, because it seems like the show today is sort of centered around that, internet social networking, how is it affecting artists today, young artists that are, you know, trying to make their careers and growing up with this in their lives?
It really does, for me, I find, provide a platform for you to get your work out there, because it is so hard to get involved with galleries in the beginning and a little intimidating. It gives you a way to start feeling better about your work, I find. But also for me, it's given me a lot of subject matter. I was working directly from the internet, and I'm finding avenues that I wouldn't be able to find if it were a different time, if I didn't have that technology. So I really find that as much as there are drawbacks with it, and there is so much out there now, and it really blurs the lines between what is art, there are so many positives that it really makes it a much more confident environment to work in.
So for you, it's a positive thing. What about you, Kyle?
Like I said, it's a very 50-50 thing, because as much good stuff as there is out there, there's as much crap.
Well, thank you very much, Aaron and Kyle. And how long does the show run until?
It's on until February 5th.
Painter Francine Savard has developed fascinating and beautiful systems of color to translate the first lines of novels. Michael spoke to her about it at Diaz Contemporary.
Hi, we're at Diaz Contemporary at the foot of Tecumseh at Niagara with Quebecois artist Francine Savard and her new show, which is really beautiful. Well, it's a real tribute to color.
Yes, I think so, yes.
Yes, and what I find interesting is the mathematics you use to create the images that you've put forth. Can we talk a bit about that?
The mathematics?
Yeah.
Oh, that's funny you choose that word, because it's mostly based on words.
Yes, yeah. But the length of the word, the number of letters, yeah, creates a certain length, like inch and centimeters.
Yeah,
right?
I would say it's based on a system that words give me the permission to work with, you know. And first it's based on a text that I try to write, and this text used only first lines of novels. So it is the first thing I put in front of me in order to base the painting on, you know. So after that, the mathematics of, as you say, the words come into works, you know.
I got you. Yeah. Now, how do you derive the color? I think of synesthesia when I see it, that the color, the word, you associate that word with a color, right?
Of course, I associate words with colors, and words that are in the same word in a different painting would be the same color.
Yes. Okay?
So I first try to associate the color of the connectors, which are not very flavored
words. You mean the A's and the A's
yes,
and the thas
and the I and you and yeah, you know yeah, yeah. Those, okay. Those things. And then for those words, I thought of making it a structure, you know, something very solid, like blacks and grays, and also the, all the punctuation will be white. So
okay.
People would recognize. And the same length.
So those are like commas?
Commas or dot.
Okay,
know?
Okay.
But not the dot of at the end of the line, of course.
Okay, okay.
And then after that, you know, I had lots of words which had more flavor, you know. So I had to think about the words in terms of what they mean, mm-hmm. and also after that, how they will resonate into a painting, and that painting, which for many of them had already lots of color that I was forced to put because of my system, you
yes.
know. And
yes.
then I have to work with what was left for me to work, and to take care of the painting, you know, mm-hmm. after all.
Well, it's a really stunning palette. Like, the colors are very harmonious, but at the same time, it's kind of troubling, you know?
It's strange that you say that, and in fact, it's true because it's kind of my palette.
Yes.
I have difficulties to go out of it, and it's kind of an exercise every time. I force myself to go out of a certain palette, and it comes to me. But you know that's how it is. And it's almost the first paintings where I use color together. You know, lots mm-hmm. of colors together.
Yeah. I usually use four. Oh, even one, right?
Even like, one.
Yeah, very pared down.
Yeah, I mean, years ago I was doing monochrome painting and with shapes, and then sometimes I would associate a word with those painting, and the word would be in a different color or in a different shade. But you know, I start now that I'm more at ease with painting,
yes.
maybe, to associate colors. But I do it only with a system, so
yeah,
I don't
decide
too much, you know.
Come and visit the Diaz Contemporary Gallery on Tecumseh Street and see Francine Savard's fabulous show that's here until February 12th.
We'll close our openings tonight with Clive d'Oliveira at Bochy Gallery, where Tali heard about his artistic heritage and triumph over tedium.
Hi, I'm here at Bochy Gallery with Clive d'Oliveira and his show Bent Geometry. Hi, Clive. So tell us about what you've created here.
The ideology, I think it's a tradition that I guess is about 80 or 90 years old now. It started in the early 1920s with a painter called Piet Mondrian. Basically, it's called concrete abstraction. This means that there's no imagery to obfuscate what painting is about. It's about paint, it's about color, it's about line, and that's it. So that's the beginnings. And my work traditionally over the last, I guess, about 25 years has a very formal structure. It's all based on the grid. It's based on precise measurements and subdividing the picture surface into areas I play. It's like a puzzle. It's like a little visual puzzle I play with myself. And I set up parameters. And the way this particular series originated was when I start my work, I get an idea, and I start to do quick little pencil drawings in a book. And for me, it's just a record. This is what I'm going to do. There's always an underlying grid structure there, but these are quick little things. I don't without the benefit of any measuring device or ruling devices. They're just there. And I think about a year ago, I was starting a new series, and I was starting to plot out my paintings and my studies. And what I do is I do these little plots, and then I translate them into little studies, and I start to put the color in, and then the studies get translated into larger canvases. And I guess I thought, this is getting really tedious, and I was looking at these things, and why don't I just try popping some color in there and see what happens? And I did, and the result was the little studies, and they started to work. Visually they worked, they had a kind of a nice quality to them with the loose lines. They're a little bit more lyrical. They still have that structure. And then I translate them into the larger canvases. I've had a lot of fun doing these, and most of these have been done just in the last 6 months. And for the first time in years, I'm working at 2 and 3 in the morning. I'm having a lot of fun with them. They're great. They're a little bit more rapid. Technically, they're not as precise as my earlier work. I'm going to do more of them. I don't know if I'm going to continue doing this, but for now, I'm having fun.
Well, you sound pretty inspired, and this doctrine, I mean, it's 80, 90 years old. Has it evolved at all, or do you think it's pretty much stayed the same since its inception?
No. I think I'm might be what's considered the fifth, perhaps the sixth generation of painters that work in this genre. And every generation brings their own little twist to it. And there are 4 or 5 other painters in Toronto that work the way I do. We're all colleagues. We know each other. We argue with each other. We have like some really insane arguments about whether a line should meet like this. And we each have our own approach. I tend to look at it as I have this underlying structure, and the springboard for me might be puzzles. Somebody else, his work is based on industrial colors, so he'll use school bus yellow and only school bus yellow and only the red of that mailbox and that kind of thing. Another guy is even more lyrical because he is quite involved with texture and the brush marks and that fluidity of paint and the way paint gets absorbed by canvas or will float on a layer of mylar.
But back to you, your previous work, I was taking a look earlier, it's a lot more precise, and I see a lot of straight lines, but this collection is not straight lines. What made you change?
Again, it was just that, I'm going to call it laziness. I looked at these little mock-ups that I was doing, and I thought, you know, the straight lines are getting just a little bit tedious, and I just needed a break, and the result is this.
Well, thank you very much for talking to us, and the show runs until January 29th, correct?
I don't know.
I know. It runs until January 29th, so make sure you check it out at Boji Gallery.
Well, ArtSync debuted in 2010, and we are overwhelmed by the talent our coverage uncovered. Looking back in a bout of nostalgia, we chose a favorite Toronto exhibit. We picked a show that's also, in many ways, about nostalgia. The David Hoffos exhibit at MoCA, Scenes from the House Dream. Mike spoke to the artist at the opening in October, and we're showing the uncut interview here for the first time. Enjoy.
I'm Mike Hansen, this is ArtSync, and we're at the MoCA, and we're with David Hoffos, who has just opened this amazing, it's phenomenal, I'm trying to think of the word here, and I don't want to be too effectual here, but it is a phenomenal show. It's like the illusions that you perpetrate in that room are stunning.
You're too kind.
Well, when I talked to David about it for a minute, David Liss, I mentioned that I felt it was very Star Wars, because you've almost created holographic movement.
Well, I mean, Star Wars is an interesting reference. I was 11 years old when Star Wars came out, so just about the perfect age for something like that, growing up in the suburbs as well. And that was also a time, like especially with movies like Star Wars and the things that Spielberg was doing, where there would often be TV specials about the making of these things. So you'd see these big kids blowing up models and that kind of stuff. So that kind of do-it-yourself filmmaking coming out of independent movements in the 70s was a huge influence. And you talk about holography, and often my work is described as hologram-like, but it's not. It's a completely low-tech, almost 19th century version of a hologram that uses two-dimensional images layered into physical spaces to create the illusions.
Yeah, I know it. I know. I love the whole fact that you're not using computers. You're using televisions. And you're playing with this whole idea of the magician and smoke and mirrors to create these suburban scenes that I think will touch a lot of people if they allow themselves to go back to their childhood and to their teenage years, especially are reflected, I think, in the work.
Well, and some of this technology comes from my childhood, and it's interesting, through the production of this work between 2003 and 2008, you can see the equipment I'm using turn into antique, actually, just through that period. I started mastering on VHS tape, and then I slowly switched to DVD. The cathode ray tube televisions that you see in there stopped being produced about 8 months ago, so those are now archaic, right? So. But that's been, in the history of my practice, something that I've always explored, hidden potentials in discarded technologies or new uses for these kind of prosaic devices.
Oh, no, I think it's fantastic to the whole aspect of the reuse, and where everybody else is switching and fighting to grasp new technology. You have created something so incredibly new and fresh in there through old technology, which I think is great. And at the same time, you were saying it's semi-autobiographical, the works.
Well, and I think in the technology, I'm attempting to kind of carve out a little bit of territory for myself that does create maybe something new and fresh, like you're saying, but using old techniques mixed with home technology or straight out of the box technology. The autobiographical element is interesting. I mean, when I started this project in 2003, the impetus was to make more personal work. I'd been making works that were horror themed or science fiction or Western romance, that kind of stuff. And I was gradually moving towards more personal subject matter. And this is the culmination of that kind of inward search that ends up, when I see this exhibition here, it's a little bit personally revealing and exposing, and so I feel a little bit vulnerable when I put this out there, but I think for me that's a success when I can see that it is kind of revealing of my own inner states or evolutions. Maybe that's one of the successes that I can see in this work.
Well, I think that lends a comfortability to it too. Like, you look at it and you go, I know that. You know, as an example, I ran into a friend of mine there who I grew up with inside, and we both said, wow, that reminds us of where we grew up.
I would hope that there's something familiar for many people, but also disquieting as well, like something that's sort of like a clash of the unfamiliar and the familiar. So, and to me, that's exactly what the uncanny is. And the uncanny is a kind of moment that I hope for the viewer to have in the space, this encounter with something that you feel like you may have not encountered before, but still has this kind of tinge of familiarity to it.
Well, and there's a certain level of creepiness too, which is interesting, because you look in these mirrors, you look into these holes in the wall, and then all of a sudden there's movement. And the movement, which is how you've been able to capture that and reflect it in, look, is at the same level as the diorama they're fitting in the sense that they don't look like film. You know, you've captured, been able to put in this great level of contrast and stuff so that they look like full-bodied images, like people. You almost think they're little tiny people in there.
It comes directly, this whole kind of thrust of my work comes directly from one assignment that I got in art school, and that was, it was simple, it was a Sculpture 2 class, and we were asked to combine image and object and to somehow create depth that didn't require any kind of special viewing apparatus. So that assignment is something that kind of stayed with me. I attempt to create illusions of presence and movement that can be experienced simply by the viewer moving through a space. They don't require 3D glasses or any kind of gear to be strapped on.
Yeah, well, that allows for the viewer to become fully participatory within the work too.
It's important to me that the viewer is in that position of dominance and that they're able to make the choices about how they approach these things, whether they see them simply as illusion or they get seduced into the fantasy of it. And then once the viewer is in that kind of ambivalent state, they can enjoy that kind of movement back and forth between the enjoyment of the effect and the discernment of its making, possibly.
What's really wild is the full-size figures that you come across in the room. And that really caught me off guard. It was sort of like, I'm there and I see this woman sitting at a table, another woman sitting on the floor, and I'm trying to think, are these people real? Like, it just made my head turned, and I went, what is this? And it was alarming, but in a very positive way. It draws you right into the whole work itself, because the work itself is a whole. Like, it's not a bunch of individual pieces. It's a true story going on in there. It's like you said, it's your film background. Like, you have a fondness for film, and it's really reflected in there.
And for, I mean, when you think about what happens when people go to see a film, they enter the dark, ritualized space of the theater. They're kind of walled up in the darkness, being fed intravenously from the screen, mm-hmm. kind of. And there is an automatic suspension of disbelief that's necessary in order to fully enjoy or appreciate the film. So I employ some of those kind of triggers, going through the curtain into the dark space, the sound and the light that kind of draws you into that world and hopefully creates that automatic suspension of disbelief that puts the viewer in a position to have that experience of encountering something that could give them a shock or a fright or a double take, like you were saying.
I think
that moment is so important. When the viewer has that moment of chagrin or shock, that's when they're fully participating in the illusion, because they've now realized that they are being tricked. And now we can go on with a little more alertness, more awareness further into the space.
Yeah. Well, it's fantastic. So thank you so much for taking the time, and congratulations. That is fantastic work.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
We're about to wrap up the show for tonight, but the galleries will be open and enticing all week. Some favorites of the new exhibits include Monica Tapp, Study Notes at Winnick Tuck Gallery, Ron Tirada, Who I Think I Am at Justina M. Barnicky Gallery, Ron G., Thought Court at Paul Petra Contemporary, Alexander David, Moving Around at YYZ, Sherry Moses, Out of Woman Breathing at the Women's Art Resource Center. By the next show, we'll have spoken to those artists and others, so be sure to come back next Friday. Meanwhile, click on over to artsync.ca, and as always, take care and keep inspired.